1945, whenever Bush talks about Memex is a machine that hopefully, in Israel, that mimics human brain. See, those of you who attended my class on semantic cognitive perception, that was our main thing. Even today, we are all working very hard and struggling. In 95, he talked about conjecture, Hitchcock conjecture, you know, Memex. And he talked about some of the fundamental thing. One of the fundamental concepts he talked about is trailblazing. Trailblazing. So he kind of said, human brain, how does a human brain think? And he basically, his view, conjecture is that human brain latches on a concept and then traverses to other concept in the context. So the concept is a node in a graph. How would you, in a computer data structure, how would you talk about that? You'll have to create a node and traverses. So a relationship in a context. Remember my favorite example of an employee works for a company, an employee owns the stock in a company. The nodes are the same, but the relations are very different. Semantics is totally different. Meaning is totally different. Right? Semantics is totally different. So, going from, so the fundamental thing about modeling semantics is relationship. And the most basic of all the relationships that I can think about is, are these two things same or different? The most basic of all. There are many, you know, different kind of relations, like the person owns stock and works for those. I know they are more advanced. Very basic. Are these the same or different? Right? And this has been a significant area of challenge and interest in semantics and semantic web. For example, the whole area is called semantic similarity, right? Semantic distance, semantic proximity, semantic relatedness. You see all these different words? They all, around the same general thing. How close are two objects? Are they same? If not, how are they related? How similar they are, how different they are, these are very fundamental things. I'm also very proud of one work that we did in this context. In 1992, I gave a keynote, so far, yet so near. So far, schematically. Yet so near, semantically. What does it say? Anybody wants to conjecture? What am I trying to say here? What am I trying to say?
Schemas are different, but meaning are same.
Right? That I may have two very different representation of an object, of a concept, but they may mean the same in our brain. You know, one of the biggest thing of interest to me now is that I have the same thing conveyed by different modality. One of the important things that we discussed in the last class, semantic cognitive perceptual computing, is that you have a concept that human brain can very closely associate, but in the textual form it may be a string versus a typed literal, or it may be a name of a person and a photograph of a person. Human brain is so marvelous that the name of a person and a photo of a person, with single instance, you can associate with them. You can say that that's for the same person. And one simply gives you, one gives you visual, you know, impression, other gives you an identifier. How hard it is for machine. Another fundamental thing we discuss about, and this is something that is very relevant to current days where people are talking about deep learning. If you look at some of the things I have shared, like Oren Etzioni's that question answer, or a number of other people are there, they notice that we still not come to a stage where like a child seem to learn from very few examples. At least today, our machines need a lot more examples for deep learning and other things of that nature. Right? So, in that context, conjecture is, and again, I share with you Oren's thing, Pablo Dominguez thing, talk, there are several others that we talked about. The conjecture is, and what I also talked about this for quite some time, is that the difference that we can't do all this purely based on data, we need to bring in knowledge and utilize the knowledge. Coming back to Vannevar Bush, so he fundamentally understood the value of relationship. I did that, of course. For me, Vannevar Bush is, you know, really, thinker, you know, the one who, you know, went way before us. But in 2002, I gave a keynote on relationship at the heart of semantics and semantic web. And then we talked about many types of relationship there. And we talked about modeling relationship, describing relationship, identifying relationship, like given two objects, what kind of relationship there is in that, discovering relationship from the data and patterns, analyzing the data, and many other pieces of that. You know, there's one paper that is entitled number of things like that. Okay, so now coming back to Tali architecture, right, and semantics architecture, what is very important to recognize, you remember that diagram, schema diagram, the architecture diagram I have shown you, right? On the left hand side, top left hand side, we have machinery for creating and maintaining knowledge bases. In our case, schema are designed by human, but the knowledge base is created automatically through these extractor agents, knowledge extractor agents. On the top left hand side, what do we have? We have contextualization part, realized through classification, which in turn uses knowledge base as one of the things in conjunction with statistical learning method, Bayesian in this case HMM. Of course, there are, now you can use SVM and many other things. So those days that we had reasons to do what we did, but you can improve upon that. So there is a context that is created for the data. Then on bottom left, there's a machinery of looking at each individual piece of data, utilizing the knowledge, classification, and then knowledge base. What do we do with classification? We find the context that helps you select the part of knowledge that is relevant in understanding this data. Imagine you're thrown any object at your brain, you read about this thing, automatically you have a lot of knowledge, some deep, some, and you read something that relates to material science, let's say, suddenly you're going to try and that is sort of complex chemical compound or, you know, other things that you have no other knowledge except that you took a course in chemistry, where you had learned something about that, or maybe you did a course in biochemistry, and you're going to, without any effort, your brain will use that part of the knowledge. What has been fundamentally missing in much of the work is that think about today's world, we have vast choices of knowledge. We have knowledge bases like Wikipedia and DBpedia and Yago derived from these things. We have Freebase. Some of you saw, I have shared that this organization is, you know, these guys and they sent us a note. They have integrated six major knowledge bases of that kind. Right? Then BioPortal has 500 plus ontologies. Right? Some of them are just schema level, others have populated, including two that we created from our group. And then we have a lot of specialized knowledge bases that some people have, some companies have created their own clinical ontologies and knowledge base. Beyond that, there are other things like Nell and others who are constantly going through web pages and trying to extract triples or, you know, entities and relationships from the web pages with social quality. But they are there. And then I can purposefully create a knowledge base. So our knowledge graph group is supposed to be creating a machinery to be able to create a knowledge graph on demand. For example, one of the very interesting things we are trying to do is we run so-called, you know, we have some software called Twitter, or Twitteries, many of you know about it. So we run a campaign on election, campaign on Uber versus Lyft. And what we want to do is to apply the, create a knowledge base that is just related to that campaign. So we have a particular task at, you know, like election thing or Star Wars for Disney or whatever, and we want to apply a we want to create, which may be through simply creating a subset. Oh, what is in Wikipedia about it? Let's take it. What is in some other place like? Take it. For example, if I'm doing something for music, I want to go to MusicBrainz, which has more than 600,000 or even, I don't know, a lot more than that, artists and all their, you know, albums and tracks and everything is there. So I want to take knowledge from that and apply it right there. If I'm talking about movies, I want to apply all the knowledge that is in IMDb and any of those databases for movies, Rotten Tomatoes and whatever, right? Forget about the intellectual property and those issues that we have to address too. But your brain does it like, you know, like that. But a very exciting thing in my view for what we had done in Thali and Simagics is that we had that mechanism to say what knowledge bases are relevant from among the ones I have. Of course, in those cases, we only had 35 different domains. Only 25. In the world, there are so many, right? But that 25 is far more than what anybody had at that time. And for 5 years after that, anybody had. So we wanted to say, okay, this is sports. I want to apply baseball. You know, this one is about baseball. So the other thing is, it say, if it's baseball, then what kind of properties or attributes or facets am I interested in? Some of you may recall Kalpa's work, right? What is Kalpa trying to do? When you do search on Google, you get that info box and you get some properties listed. But those properties that are listed are arbitrary, you know, just some from Wikipedia. What Kalpa is doing is say, if I have only so much space, if I only show 5 properties, can I choose diverse properties? Will that satisfy human need better than choosing all the 5 properties from that person's family thing or professional thing alone? Right? So. So what we did was that we will extract the metadata that is relevant to the domain that has been identified, the context. Context is the domain, and we would find that particular metadata that is relevant to that particular domain. We don't look for stock value, you know, thing when we know that this is a sports article, right? We don't look for team name when I know that there is a financial article. So that creates, you know, that creates a system that makes a tight system. You don't have to apply entire knowledge base because there's too much knowledge. You will have to look for, try to match all the entity names for this proper noun that you found. That will waste a lot of resources. The number of ages you will have to traverse would be exponential, right, with respect to the number of nodes, right? Complete graph algorithm. So we wanted to say, I know, it's just like our brain also seems to be, right? It's not going to try and remember everything we have when we look at data. No, we quickly contextualize and we will apply just the thing that may be in that domain. So you see that in a way was motivated from that general principle. Then we extracted contextually relevant metadata, aided by the knowledge base, referencing it or basically disambiguating it, and linking it to the ontology, entity linking it to the ontology, and stored in our metabase. The difference was that the entire web structure was within our system. Once we create knowledge, it was not outside. So I'm not making URL to the thing on the web. In the ideal world, you might want to, because then when somebody changes something in Wikipedia, automatically changes, and I don't have to change it in my system, it is right there. But you have to make all the costs to BP and wait for them to give a thing, and you can't scale, right? So, so you see now a rough, thing as to how that, fundamental, several differences, right? These are, Ludwig has a nice thing, and my answer to him was, first of all, good effort. But my answer is, you saw the trees, but missed out the forest. The forest was to understand a couple of aspects, meaning understand the central rule of knowledge base. And the other thing was this whole thing about contextualization. And there's a little bit more I need, about relationship and all that. But I think that's probably enough for today.
Compared to Tali's faith and then what's being done here now, 15-16 years later, considering the core part of the semantics, is it still the same, or is there any, game-changing additions now that it's more successful?
Brilliant question.
Something like that.
Brilliant question. And it's Ritvik asking not one of my PhD students.
What's
credit to you?
Now?
No, very good question. So here's the problem. Many of my students don't learn what I did 15, 20 years ago. And so what happens is then they just have to reinvent, and they kind of get to those ideas 3 years, 4 years into their PhD. So the progress is never linear, going up and going up. And that's why I think I insist that they should, attend at least my core course. I think we keep on coming back to some of the core things. And as I said, I won't even take all the credits of that time. I will, give credit to Vannevar Bush for some of the very fundamental thing he said then. The realizations keep on changing. So some of the core ideas, like semantic proximity, like the contextualization we did, like the automatic knowledge maintenance, we keep on revisiting them in a different context. For example, Sarasi and Saida and some other people are working on a project called Noesis Knowledge Graph Generation Platform. So we had, remember, the knowledge base creation infrastructure. I don't have access to that code anymore. It's in the company, this thing. And we did a lot of engineering work, just like Twitter system. We had 6-7 PhDs put in the work, but then it took engineers. Alan Smith, we have Jeremy, there's another guy, to make it, very robust and scalable and all this stuff. So some of the things we do are revisiting some of the old ideas. They may not know it, but they are doing it. Some of them are new ideas. So there are some fundamental difference compared to what we did before. So in my earlier work and this Tali and other kind of work, we did use statistical learning or machine learning in a rather limited way. Only in the context of the classification we used it. Now we are doing a lot more. So Shweta or Monere or Amir or Hussein or number of these guys and Manas, they're all working on using machine learning and NLP techniques, and in much more broader way than we ever did then. Right? So there is certainly advancement, certain level, what has happened is that you have to, if you're smart, you should realize that you don't know everything, and you have to learn from others. I think I'm smart because I know that I don't know everything. And in that sense, what we did is that I think we had a tremendous success. Even though Tali did not become Google, and that had more to do with not technology but business issues and all that. I think I could be wrong. Who knows? But what has happened? And even though I had that exchange with Norwig, right? It is undeniable that Norwig and people in that, from coming from that perspective, had tremendous success, undeniable, right? Until very recently, when Google started using semantics, which is only after 2010.
Is that the same model you took the Google semantics?
Somewhat. Knowledge graph creation, in fact, is less automated than even Tali had. I can go into that, explanation further. But the fact that they are using now knowledge base, they learned the kind of techniques that I was very much involved in and did a long time ago, and some others did. At the same time, I learned that they had a lot of successes. The scale, the ability to process a lot more variety, large amount of data, the ability to do annotations using machine learning techniques. They really had big successes, right? So, I've been talking about use of machine learning, statistical techniques, combined with our stuff. And you saw our example in that paper, right, where we used this classifier Bayesian, and we were aware of it, not that yet, but we used that to a very limited way. Kind of not enough. I just didn't have bandwidth, and we had more success with this semantic thing, which did not use so much of the more structured data rather than more unstructured data. So we didn't do image processing, where again these things will play a big role. The same way, people coming in AI from machine learning, like Pedro Dominguez and Oren Zioni and many other people, and some of my students will know. They are also talking about knowledge base now, increasingly. I think they started talking about knowledge base after I did. But they had a lot more advances and successes with statistical things, with machine learning, with deep learning and all that, which I never did. So I think we are both, we are seeing the value on the other side. And now, in this group, we are trying to combine the two things as well as possible. And we have several. The other thing is, we are on some topics our attention has shifted. In that, I'm a lot more interested in doing things with multimodal data. So I had a paper 3 years ago called physical cyber social computing. So, because I noticed that, and then we had a workshop and everything, like Dachstuhl seminar, I noticed that there are increasing number of applications, that for the single application, we are exploiting physical, meaning sensor or Internet of Things related data, cyber data, like web-based data, and social data on networking sites and other things like that. We're combining all of them in a single application. Similarly, we have increasing number of use cases where we need to deal with, for solving one problem, the multimodal data, textual data, image data, video data, analog data coming from sensor, and so on and so forth. Right? So that variety of data, I think the most cited paper on heterogeneous database is my paper called federated databases. So we always did work on heterogeneous databases. Also, the first tutorial ever given on heterogeneous database was one I gave in 1987 in International Data Engineering Conference. So we always had that. But the type of heterogeneity is now, earlier the heterogeneity was in just structured databases, then like schema heterogeneity, then heterogeneity was in text versus structured databases, and secret. And now we are going more towards heterogeneity in modalities and other things of that nature. The other interesting thing that is going on is complexity of the problems that we are solving. So I'll give you a couple of examples that is happening here that we did not do before. We have Sujan did his thesis on so-called implicit entity. So his work is legitimately the first work on that topic. Okay. So there is no mention textual, of the word in the text, and yet you are identifying that, oh, this is edema. So edema is a medical condition of heart, or rather swelling and other things. And here is a text that Ayurveda defines is a swelling of da da da. There's nothing, and he's able to identify that. That kind of association is something which is very hard to do purely on using any statistical technique, any syntactic occurrences, because there's no letter or words that are matching, right? So such a thing can be only done through a knowledge base, or that is our assertion. And Sujan's solution, it involves knowledge base as the central component of the solution. The other example is that Sanjaya, for example, is doing, again, I think it might end up being pioneering work on emojis. I want you, all the students, to recognize this. This is a beautiful thing. See, Sujan's work, I don't have to work hard to sell it. By the way, it was very hard to get Sujan's papers accepted in a traditional conference, in a mainstream conference. I was about to share with my students, about this question on Quora about citation. How do you get high citation? So I have some interesting thing, we have a number of papers that were originally sent to the top conferences and didn't get accepted. We sent to the second or third year conference, got accepted, and have 100 plus citation there. Okay. So, really, there's this problem of people with open mind. So the complexity of the problem solving is such that you not solved before, one thing. And the importance was very clear. So the point I was making is that try and find the problems where it's hugely important and yet others have somehow missed. You look at people who have won Nobel Prize, people who have been vastly successful. The solution doesn't have to be terribly complex. The idea has to be the most important. The problem you're solving is to be the most important problem. That is far more important. So all I have to do is to talk about, when I want to talk about implicit entities, do you know that 40% of the book mentions on on Twitter are not explicit? Do you know 21% of the movie mentions are not explicit? And only 3 years ago we ever came across this. Until that, I see no discussion in the literature that has mentioned, that has identified this as a problem. Similar things might happen with Sanjay's work on emoji. Do you know the percentage of social media posts that have emoji? Very, very large percent. I forget the number. I think we have some data. And where is the work on automatically understanding emoji use? And where is the work on automatically helping users identify just the right emoji? And here, then, I'm encouraging Sanjaya to do the work that simultaneously uses emoji as an image and text. So multimodal thing. Earlier, the fundamental, we had a wonderful, excellent PhD thesis, in my view, promote thesis. He had paper in IIII and, you know, very precise journal. And where he uses sensor data from road, Twitter data about traffic incidents, and multiple knowledge sources, and solve the problem using machine learning, using statistical data model, linear dynamical system.
Right?
Statistical graph model.
The emergency response project, is that?
No. This was in the traffic, understanding of traffic issues. But he used statistical model. So so the PhD students understand this, you know, thought process. See, what I really wanted to get into statistical data models, you know, statistical graph models. And I got promoted to do that work. All the credit about doing the work to him, but getting that path, that is the advisor's thing, to push somehow directly, indirectly, this thing. I don't necessarily know that, final thing, but I know the, area that is good one, the right one to do. I know what is important. I recognize as soon as there is something important, something significant, why is significant. So I didn't care whether Sujan's paper did not make it into the top NLP conference we submitted to. I was totally, sure this was important, and I'm sure I'll be proven right here. So I think that hopefully gives you an answer. And we do, the other thing is that compared to the past, although DALI was commercial system, so it was real world and all that. But now in the last 5 years almost, we do almost all projects have real world users or partners or real problems. So we have, marijuana usage, or we have harassment on social media, or we have disaster, response kind of stuff. We have asthma in children, we have dementia in elderly people. Look at all this, these are all funded problems. They're all solving some significant real world problem. So our students have huge benefit. Actually, I'm surprised at the number of people finding Kalpa's resume and reaching out. Very, very exciting, very exciting. I think the things have just changed in terms of, so I was just writing a letter for somebody for his promotion to professorship. And, I see that, and then as, he teaches courses on semantic web. So probably he may be this, I think we might have had, I started teaching course in 2001, semantic web, and he did too. And I think, we should be number one and two in number of students we have trained in semantic web. Of course, I have trained a lot more PhD students also. But now why suddenly, what has happened is that a lot of our students were recruited for things other than the strength in semantics, semantic web. And the number of requests I'm getting, where people say, I want to hire somebody, I'm looking for somebody for, with knowledge of ontologies or semantic web techniques, and or combined semantics with, use of knowledge base with NLP or machine learning, has gone up. I got earlier requests from IBM, Siemens, even Amazon reached out. Because you know Amazon has Alexa system? How would Alexa work without knowledge? So you see Apple Siri, you see IBM Watson, you see Google Semantic Search, you see Amazon Alexa. These are the most successful thing out there, among many others. And now you see everybody understands that none of this could have been possible. They all use machine learning, no doubt, or NLP in that. But none of them now, you can say none of them could be possible without semantics. So, and there are only very, very few groups where people get training both in in semantics, machine learning, NLP. We are at the very attractive part of things. My problem would be that my students will start getting requests well before they are ready to graduate. So that will be a problem. But we'll leave it there.
So can I also add something to this question? So your question is a great question in this level actually. Semantic web is still in practice. So we're learning from each other. So before two talks, the concept of resources, RTF, URI actually emerged, and then interlink data, as Dr. Shep mentioned, and then the concept of the for interlink data, you need open data, so the concept of open data emerged. So still it's in practice, and it's a long way to reach
so
to the...
So it's more like the foundations are strong, and you are just ironing out the details. Like
yes, no, but there's other thing what happened. And I'm, you know, Saida not comes from a little different part, so I'm not sure you, you know, totally agree or such. But what happened is that we wasted first 5 years of semantic web. And the reason we wasted is that the semantic web when came out. So semantics and web was known well before the word semantic web came. I have paper by my very first PhD student, Vipul Kashyap, where we had a technical report in 2003 and paper in 1993 and paper in CIK in 2004 where we talk about use of multiple ontologies.
Yeah.
You know, where a query is done on ontology and through transformation it is posed on data in resource database describe or with different schema describe using different ontology, right? Kind of things you kind
yeah,
of look at.
Yeah, old concept, but semantic web reuse that.
Not just ontology, but you know, even to focus on semantics. But what happened then is that, and this is very personal view, and I may be wrong actually, I must say, start with saying that. But that the first assignment you did, you know, with teams, you know, he's a, you know, 1,000-pound gorilla, right? I mean, he's a, when team says something, everybody pays attention. So, team happened to join with Handler and Lasila, and there, Handler comes from AI, Lasila comes from metadata. We got, and the end product you saw, and then in within W3C, although RDF was became recommended in 1998. I told you that I used first RDF. I also have a paper in 1998 using RDF for metadata reference link between two resources, describing metadata on them. But too much then investment went on to, so what happened was that you need both the ideas and you need money. And where there's more money, people will do more work. Doesn't mean that that work is useful. So what happened was that Jim Handler was a program manager at DARPA. And he, I think, was very successful in getting 56 or 76 or some such very large amount of million of money, dollars of money. I don't know exact amount, I forgot. Very large amount of money, I would say, to do AI thing. And he basically defined, you know, he sponsored. I don't know who came up with the original idea or something, but he specifically was the guy who sponsored the project called DAMA, DARPA Agent Markup Language. Now underline the word agent. Okay? That comes from intelligent agents, that comes from AI mindset. And then DARPA and this corresponding effort in Europe called OI. And they came together, and then Tim Berners-Lee is the also director of W3C, World Wide Consortium, which is also the standards making body for the web, right? So all this XML and everything came from that in standards versions of it. So all the people involved in that thing, and it, you know, it's necessarily like-minded people, you know, basically end up working like-minded also. Team, you know, sorry, Jim being AI guy, ended up, you know, for whatever reason, all the people who got funded for DAML project, you know, all those millions of dollars were AI people. Not database people, not distributed computing people, not other things that will involve scalability things. You know, database people always work with very large amount of data, so scale was always part of that. Distributed computing always worried about scale also. And so large amount of people that got funded and did the work are so-called people from the frame logic and the description logic of part of the AI. This part of the things have never scaled much, in my view. So again, people might pick fight with me or disagree with me, but this is what I think. And much of the attention go to this OWL language. It's interesting language, it's useful at some level. But roughly then, from 2000 to 2005 time frame, 6-5 time frame, even a little bit beyond, there were these two distinct parts of semantic community. One part was all these AI guys with the logic base, logic, okay? That's very important. Not probabilistic logic, not statistics, not learning, not any of those things, right? And much of the resources went to them, and they ended up writing most of the papers, and they ended up telling people how to build a semantic web. Now, notice that I was an exception. I don't come from the logic background. I do have a paper, and I was actually a program project manager for a $1.6 million DARPA project called AI Database Integration. This was in 1997-98 time frame when I was working for a division of Unisys, my second job. So at that point, in my first job also, I worked with Prolog, and so I've done some of those things, but my thesis and my original training is in database. And so, and also, I worked in companies, so I was practical. I did the work that became commercial product, like InfoHarness in 1994-95, very early. Faceted search engine, very, one of the first, maybe first. So, I was an exception, really. And that's when we built Thali, started in 1999, that we found in October 1999, came from Media Anywhere project, which was done in 98. So it's, even before semantic web, we had this metadata on web data and all that stuff. Of course, as soon as I saw the word semantic web, I said, this is going to be a winner. Because team has said so, and semantics is important. And I used to work on semantics all these years. So 90% of the people worked on this OWL kind of stuff, and reasoning and formal semantics and consistency of knowledge base and all of those problems. None of them led to any commercial, or there were some toy commercial things, there is company or semi-toys. I mean, there are reasoning systems that have been built and all that. But a simple thing is that I realized that a typical programmer who has a bachelor's or a master's, she's not going to to do anything with logic. I knew very early that people are not going to, really learn how to build a logic-based system and learn description logic and learn the inferencing and all that. I knew that people would, want to use C++ or Java, or PHP, and then later on Python, right? I also knew the need for scalability or anything like this. And I also need to work with the real problem, with the industry. So having done the company, I had to solve real industry problems anyway, right? So I did subscribe from very beginning because of my interest in relationships, RDF, because RDF allows you to model relationship as a first class object. But I never was too keen on OWL. We did use OWL, we did design ontologies in OWL and all that. But in terms of building working system in commercial grade or that kind of system, I never saw a value of OWL. So this 90% of people in semantic web, like in conferences and all that, working with logic base, coming from logic background or formal logic background or this thing, they suck all the oxygen away. And their version of semantic web, of building intelligent agent based on logic-based thing, based on OWL, never materialized. Right? That is the whole point. If you look at intelligent, how did Berners-Lee, Handler, you know, the Silla article talked about building intelligence. What was their plan? What was their, you know, prescription? No, it was based on, you know, using description logics.
Oh yeah, the horn closes and stuff.
Yeah.
No, I still feel that this paper you just mentioned, the handler maybe, they were talking more about converting the HTML format to shoe readable format rather than, you know, finding what you want like that. They were more like...
But what was the motivation example? Travel, right? Travel research?
I don't think so. The computer science department, that was the example.
Didn't they use travel reservation example in this paper?
No.
Okay.
I still
Searching
think that
the
main focus was I still feel that the main focus was converting into shoe format and then querying the, you know, it's more like you still search for the tags, but you search for a different kind of tag. I still feel it's that the paper talks about that.
Oh, there are other papers or other things from the same time where basically the main motivation example was a person wants to make a travel agent, travel reservation, and the agents will do it for you. So, compared to what you saw in Tali, where we are doing search for, you know, semantic search basically, that's what you're browsing or advertisement or all those things. Anyway, much of the funding went to people who did these, you know, descriptive logic and OWL and those kind of stuff. And that unfortunately never scaled. Interestingly, even RDF did not scale for a long time until recently. Now there are some very large RDF knowledge bases and some, you know, computations using RDF is being done. But I remember going to Semantic Technology Conference, which is an industry conference. And the people basically say, who wanted to use semantic value, said, my biggest problem is that I can't scale. I can't build billions of web pages, I can't build hundreds of millions of facts. So, and the computational thing that people from the logic were interested in were these inferencing techniques, inference engines, and that. And that was, the kind of computation they can do are very limited, in my view. So, for example, one computation which I think is very relevant is path computation. Say, how are these two objects related? Through multiple intermediate nodes.
That's actually in the graph, the data is very crucial because most of the database management system are very slow for finding paths.
But that is practically very important.
Yeah, very
but
very
that an inference engine is not used for that. So what happened, the other simple way of putting it is that if you think about model of a person who would build a system, such a person could not understand description logic too well and deal with the computational tools you have, like inference engine, to solve the problem that needs to be solved. But instead, if you thought more of a graphical, you know, this is a graph representation, and then did the computation, that worked very well. So actually, even though you've not seen that part of the Tali Simagics work, so Tali was merged with WCAT, and that was acquired by it became Simagics. So this is 2002-03 time frame. There we built anti-money laundering system or know your customer system. And the know your customer system is that given a person who is or an organization who is trying to open a bank account. Find if he has any association, direct or indirect, with a whole bunch of objects that are coming from multiple sources. Bank of England watch list, FBI watch list, blah, blah, blah. So this was the path computation problem. So that is what we implemented. Now, you can conceptualize this as solving problem on RDF. But there's no role, per se, of OWL and reasoning, inferencing. Right? So what happened is that over the period of time, 90% or very large number of we focused on description logic as a core enabler for semantic web. Very small, thought about as a graph and other things like database-centric thing. Those guys ultimately, you know, because of the lack of success and then funding running out, reduce. And then team also made another strategic bet and sort of contribution. He supported this thing called link data or link token data. So the focus came back on data rather than logic and knowledge based representation modeling.
Yeah, but because once we have data, the other data, we didn't have so much trickle in the beginning.
You didn't have trickle, we had a lot of data.
We had data, but it
was... But Tally Semantic Engine worked with the entire web data.
After actually data, Atom started to convert data to triples.
But Tally Metabase was all triples.
Yeah, I mean... It was
and we had tens of millions of them. Tens of millions of triples.
Yeah, but nobody knows.
You guys in the academy are not there. You were there. We used to deal with that.
Yeah.
But anyway, so then now if you look at semantic web, also semantic web, quote unquote, Google does not use IDEA. Google does not use OWL. Or at least until last I know it did not. IBM Watson does not use OWL. You go through all these examples we talked about.
Watson uses RDF.
Yes, RDF. RDF,
yeah,
in, but even there.
As a backbone.
Even there, RDF may be used as a model, but RDF may not be used as a computational thing. It may be, you'll be basically thinking of it as a graph.
Just on the property of Wikipedia, they use for some kind of verification. They don't use IDF data for extracting, or they don't use any kind of ontology or such, just property of the Wikipedia for some actually special.
So,
when I saw the documentary, it said that based on the data it has, it hypothesizes a few scenarios and then go checks for facts. To hypothesize a scenario, you need RDF and
next time I won't come in the class.
So don't throw me out of the class.
Next time we exclude like that.
So, I hope, but I think, I need it because these two guys, I need to prepare some of these I'm saying.
So you're taking this class this semester?
Yes.
Or
first time. They got a waiver from the courses. So come, try and reflect on what are the core things of importance among our conversation. Think about the fundamental things that define semantics or meaning. Think about fundamental things involved in modeling things in the role of relationships. Think about computation necessary to identify when two things are same or different and those kind of stuff. Think about wonderful concepts like trailblazing, which is again path traversal, contextual path traversal.
Yeah, we will actually
of, yeah.
See it.
Then think about what exactly logic based formalism gives you, what competition you can do with inferencing, which I did not discuss much about, but it's something you need to think about. Think about computations that can be enabled by graph based representation and computations. Now graph computations are not easy because almost all path algorithms are NP complete, right?
Dr. Shah, sorry, can you repeat again what think about? Just repeat a few words you said.
Think about it's never possible. Think about what is fundamental about semantics and the questions to ask about when two objects are same or different. Think about the role of relationship. Think about the need to model relationship as first class object and why RDF is so important in that case. Think about the origins of OWL and the description logics and the role of description logic in modeling knowledge. And yet, failure in scaling the system using inferencing-based computational strategies. Think about actually what computations, what problems inferencing can solve, versus problems you for which you will need to use graph traversal and path computations and all that, right? So what I'm saying is that think about what is meant by the word that you will see a lot is reasoning. What do you mean by reasoning? And what are the different ways you, what are the different, you know, you reason? Is inferencing reasoning? Is path traversal reasoning? Is subgraph identification reasoning? Right? So these are all possible things within those realms. Then think about, reflect on the fact that there are some problems that can be solved very well by, you know, these models that are semantic web related models, either RDF and or OWL, but yet there is such a significant need to use statistical models, particularly statistical graph. So just pure graph as an entity in relation, a labeled graph. So you have unlabeled graph, you have labeled directed directed graph, you have labeled graph. So there's all this, your colored graph, you see this, all these formulas of graph. And think about the expressiveness versus computational trade-off that they represent, right? So problem with again description logic and problem with OWL and other things is the computational cost and how much you get for the complexity of knowledge representation. What do you get for that? And can you scale even if you get something? Can you scale to solve the real-world problem? So think about that. Then think about development of semantic web-based solution. Reflect on what you saw in the semantic web in action paper by Jeff, and core components that it enables: modeling the ontology, URLs, and creating that, and then doing something with the tagging and all that, right? Which is important, very important. Versus what kind of things you saw in the same system that are also built in 2000-2001, which is this Tali system, which had this components of creating the knowledge, utilizing knowledge, classification, contextualization, creating the metadata, exploiting the metadata, and the knowledge base in search, browsing, advertisement, personalization, other things that are different, define a pattern. Think about the prototypical examples that different people have presented over a period of time. Whether in those early days, so look at, try and go for, find more papers from and or presentations from Tim Berners-Lee, from Handler, from Jeff, from me, and from Craig Knobloch, he did pretty good job, work in ISI and others, and see what examples they used for, why they wanted to use semantic web, what kind of problems they wanted to solve. This would be very important for you to understand why we made the choices we made, right? So suppose your problem was to look at consistency in knowledge base, then I will use OWL. Then I will use inferencing to check for that disparity in representation. I must model constraints of certain kinds. OWL gives you the ability to do that. How much it is important to use that, in your problem solving, it depends. Sometimes it is important, sometimes it is not. So in large number of problems, it's not, which is where I focused on. In some problems, it is, which is where, but it's small number of problems, and this is where some other people focused on. Reflect on why RDF, why graph model is not more successful than RDF, which is not more successful than OWL. Reflect on that in terms of both representational power and computability. Right. So these are some of the things that we, discuss. I hope you noted them down. If you did not, you'll have still the video to go back to. Anything else? So I do want you to not get, as I say, don't get into the weeds. Don't just focus on trees. Focus on also try and understand what the forest, that this thing, you know, big picture. Because you think about it, some of these ideas about knowledge creation, task contextualization, all this could not have been come by just looking at, I'm going to tag the data kind of thing. See, that, I think there is a different perspective. Usually, I will give, if I have some success, I will give a lot of credit to focus on applications and solving, finding complex enough problems that I can solve with technology. As opposed to the other way around, saying, I know this technology and I'm going to find an application for it. Yeah? That is why also in my work, I also always argued that once you have identified a problem, you do need to have ability to capture the right level of richness of that problem. That means you do need to have expressive mechanism even if you face initially computability problem. So that in a way I'm kind of contradicting myself. But I found that in most of the case, I could conceptualize the problem much better with graph models than I could with logic-based representation.
Yeah.
So why should you learn RDF? Yeah.
RDF is... an excellent, I think RDF and graph both have, non-RDF graph, both have their roles. And to the extent that you are dealing with hundreds of millions of triples, I think RDF provides you a decent choice with more expressiveness than just doing a graph would. On the other hand, if the moment you realize that you need a probabilistic graph, I would go for probabilistic graph and not RDF.
Yeah. I mean, we can devote our time to that aspect of semantic, but that is successful in application.
And increasingly, probabilistic graph will be more important thing. That is why I steered Pramod to that. So we will see more of that. We'll see more statistics in our work. In a way that is wonderful, right? Because for example, you have more interest in that aspect. Amir has more interest in coming from that side. And I just want to make sure that you understand the other part so you can combine. So it's a win-win, right? I mean, I'd say win when people with strong skills with dealing with the relevant mathematics for deep learning and neural nets kind of thing. It's a good benefit that once you have that, but you also know this, then you'll be able to come up with this. So today I had a wonderful discussion with Saida where we talked about Saida is a brilliant
eyes. That's a secret.
Yeah. No, I won't talk about it. Yeah. I think Saida has come up with a brilliant use case or application where she might be able to combine neural nets with structured knowledge. Yes, that I've been wanting us to do. So that may be a use case. We'll see how if she can do faster or if Shona can do faster, you can do faster. Or maybe you guys can solve different problems. But that's what I'd like to do.
Okay, so today is over.